Thanks for checking out this No Spoilers movie review. Surprise, surprise, it's for Slumber Party Massacre II, a 1987 film that is currently streaming, when I'm recording this, on the Shudder streaming service, so you could check it out there. As you'll notice, there's no "the" at the beginning of the title on this one, only in the first one. So Slumber Party Massacre II. I'm going to go ahead and tell you right off the bat, I didn't really like this film. If you go back and watch my review for the first one, which you should, especially if you want to watch this one, I enjoyed that one. I thought that one was a lot of fun. It wasn't anything like crazy new. Like I said, it was very much like Halloween. They just changed a few things. They use that same story and formula, basically. But this one was a very big departure. And actually, in this one, they riffed a lot on A Nightmare on Elm Street. So they went from Halloween to A Nightmare on Elm Street. A lot of aspects of it were kind of taken out of there. And there was even a very heavy nod at one point to A Nightmare on Elm Street, where there's a police officer whose name is Officer Krueger. So there you go. But you'll see what I mean if you've already seen this movie, or if you're going to see this movie, you'll see what I'm talking about. So yeah, not a big fan of this one because, well, I'll get into it. Like I said, a 1987 film. So this is, what, 5 years after the first one, I believe? This was written and directed, again, by a female. The first one was written by a female and directed by a different female. This one, written and directed by the same female. And this individual did Rock and Roll High School Forever. That was another film that she wrote and directed. And it's kind of funny because in this movie, in Slumber Party Massacre 2, there's a point where some of the characters are watching television and Rock and Roll High School's on. So the fact that she went on to do Rock and Roll High School Forever, it's kind of funny. This is definitely tied into the first movie. They make that apparent immediately because there are all these flashbacks to scenes from the first one. So it really lets you know, hey, this isn't going to be basically like a standalone like some of these sequels are. It's directly tied into it. And I mean, I'm fine with that, but how they chose to do it. There's some very heavy foreshadowing in this, which I don't think was at all necessary. It's totally unnecessary because people who have seen the first film, usually people are going to see the first film and then see the sequel. You know what you're going to get. Like, you have a very good idea of what will happen. You know the events of the first one. So you don't need the heavy foreshadowing like they have in this. Like, you know things are going to go bad. It's a horror film. It's a sequel, nonetheless. You can do that with an original film. But with this one, when it's sequels, you don't need the heavy foreshadowing in the beginning. You don't need any foreshadowing in the beginning, to be honest. So one of the interesting things, the first film was very focused on women who were kind of like bimbos, as I said in there, not that intelligent. But then this one actually kind of flips that around and it focuses more on the women being in a more power position. It focuses a lot and has a lot of themes about women taking control of relationships that they're in. So much stronger female characters. And the guys in this actually are kind of portrayed as like pretty much idiots, including one of the guys who actually tries his hardest to do his Sean Penn from Fast Times at Ridgemont High. If people haven't seen it, he's Spicoli, a stoner surfer guy. So there's a character who's trying to rip that character off in this. Not doing a very good job, though. There's a great quote from this that I wrote down that I just love the quote. The quote was, "Sunday's my birthday, and I don't want to go to a mental hospital." That's a funny quote, and B, so true. Who wants to go to a mental hospital on their birthday? Nobody. Anyway, I just really like that quote, so I had to put it in there. The nightmare and flashback scenes in this end up getting crazy, excessive, and become very, very, very annoying. That is one of my biggest problems with this film. It's over and over and over with the nightmare and flashback scenes, and you're just like, okay, we got it. We get it. You can lay off this for now. Get to the killing. And that's the other thing, is the killing doesn't happen until, like, I don't know, 45 minutes, 50 minutes into it or something. And it's a film that's only like an hour and 20 minutes. So it takes forever. Whereas the first film did a good job and they got pretty much right into it. I think I had said on that review that they that there was a kill within the first 10 minutes. I think it was like at minute number 8 or something. So they should have followed that and done the same thing, but they didn't. Ugh. Sexuality and nudity in this is way toned down. Way, way, way toned down. It's still there, and there's actually a big theme around sex. And actually, it's mainly a theme around the pressures of sex, the pressures of especially high school aged people to have sex, and the kind of conflicting feelings of like, well, I want to, but at the same time, I kind of don't want to. It's scary. What happens if, you know, something goes wrong? Because I do think that the killer in this is actually kind of a metaphor for sexually transmitted diseases, believe it or not. If you have watched this, or if you do watch this, let me know what you think about that. Do you think that makes sense, or am I just totally making that up? Put a comment down there. But yeah, so it's this big theme of sexual pressure, like to give into sexual pressure or to not, from your peers, from someone you're interested in. I think that's one of the big themes in this. But with that, you know, the sexuality and nudity is toned down from the first one. There's not nearly as much nudity, but there is still a scene where it's like, wait a minute, when women are alone, they still like to get naked together. So kind of hearkening way back to the first one. So it takes a while to get into things in this film. It takes its sweet time. Like I said, the first one just jumps right into it, and I hate the fact that it takes forever to get places. The other thing tied into the whole sexual theme of this, I think it's making a very good point about consent in the film, because there are numerous times where, to also go along with women having the upper hand in relationships and taking control of relationships, it shows numerous instances where women are kind of telling the guys how it is. Like, they're like, oh, do you want to do it now? And they're like, eh, I don't think so. So it's kind of making a good point about sexual consent. The main weapon from the killer, which is the same as in the first one, but it's heavily stylized in this one, really updated, and it looks really cool. It looks really, really cool. But I think that also can symbolize in this, with all the sexual context, can symbolize rape, actually. So once again, let me know what you think, people. I already went over that one. The guys are portrayed as idiots, did that. Seems really slow. This film is only about an hour and 20 minutes, and it seems crazy slow. That's not a good thing, especially when it's only about an hour and 20 minutes. So bad, bad, bad. And it just kind of feels like there's not much of any actual payoff. When they give you payoff, I hate how they do it. It's terrible. It just doesn't work for me. And I wrote this down. With how bad that film is, it's crazy to think, yes, there was a Slumber Party Massacre 3. Slumber Party Massacre 3. Get that through your head, especially after you've watched this. Watch this movie, then get that through to your head. They did a third one, which I guess I feel like I have to find that now. It's not on Shudder at the moment. I feel like I got to find it. There's the very heavy nod to Nightmare on Elm Street. I already went over that. So there's a portion toward the end where the killer does something that's super, super over the top. And I was sitting there and I was like, what? Really? We're doing this? We're doing this? It is crazy over the top. It comes out of nowhere. It makes the movie ridiculous. And the problem is, at that point, you've gone too long trying to be serious, that when you throw in that ridiculous twist and make it just over the top ridiculous, it doesn't work. You needed to introduce the ridiculousness of it from the beginning, pretty much. And that's one of the problems. Like, it's about balance. There are films that the whole thing's going to be ridiculous, or the whole thing's going to be serious, or it's going to be a mixture. And it's hard to get the mixture right, but if you're going to do the other two, they kind of need to be just about fully about that, about being either fully serious or being fully ridiculous. You know, you can mix in a little bit, but the problem is, it's this. There's no mixing at all. It's like the film's just like serious, 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 serious. And then it hits towards, I don't know, like the 50-minute mark or an hour mark or something, and then it becomes ridiculous. And that does not work. It makes people turn around and just be like, what? What? Because you're in the mode of thinking that they're trying to do something that's actually scary, that's very serious, and then they throw out the ridiculousness. Whereas something like a, you know, Chopping Mall, a movie like that, it's ridiculous from the get-go. Or, what's another one? Basket Case. Ridiculous from the get-go. So you can enjoy it for that reason. This one, ugh, God, the mixture, it's bad. It's just really bad. Also, there's too much music in this. And I'm not talking about the score to it. I'm talking about musical scenes where people in the film are performing music. Especially very much towards the end. And if you've seen this, you know what I'm talking about. If you watch it, you will see what I'm talking about. Well, hear what I'm talking about and see. Terrible. Just awful. If you're going to go... Oh, and yeah, and then I just put, if you're going to go ridiculous, you got to do it immediately. So, but that's actually it. Like I said, you can probably tell, I was not a fan of this film. I did not like it. If they would have made it ridiculous from the get-go, I think I could have found a lot to enjoy in it. Once this film is fully resolved, you're like, no thank you. Not a fan of that. Terrible. Because they also employ something that a lot of people roll their eyes at nowadays, especially. So, yeah. But this is going to be hard. My 5-star scale for rating with half stars in play, I'm going to give this a 1.5. I got to give it a 1.5. I could bump it up to a 2 if all the musical stuff wasn't thrown in there, because that takes it even further into the ridiculous. Yeah, but 1.5 stars, obviously not good. Don't recommend it. Unless you're a completist and you're like, well, I saw the first one, gotta see the second one. I can't even imagine what the third one's gonna be like, but I kind of feel like I need to see it now. Ah, crap. Someone put a comment down there and warn me if I'm going to see the third one, if that's okay, or if I'm in for a terrible time. But thanks everyone for checking this out. Please spread the word about my channel. That can help me out a lot, but really hit that subscribe. It takes you literally like a second. It can mean a lot for me. Totally painless for you. Put some comments down there. Have you seen this? Are you going to see it? Let me know. And give me some likes if you want to. But thank you so much for checking this out. And until next time, keep it brutal.